I wanted to read from the Gospel of Matthew. I'm going to read some maybe familiar words, but words that I often turn to at different times in different seasons. So I'm reading from Matthew chapter 5, and I'm going to begin reading at verse 1 and probably take it through to verse 12. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, the disciples came to him. Then Jesus began to speak, and he taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hidden. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven." As some of you perhaps will notice, I've taken that reading on a little bit further, just picking up on the words that Jesus gives us about living as disciples. So I thought I'd share a little firstly about something that's happening in my garden just recently. The lower end of my garden has suddenly burst into brilliant colour. It is the least ordered section, I have to admit, of the garden, to put it mildly. Last year, I had my neighbour peering over the fence, asking me if it had been my positive intention to rewild that particular section of the garden. Had I scattered those rewilding seeds on the soil that he had heard so much about and seen around and about on his travels in Hull? No, it has just happened quite naturally, I explained rather sheepishly at the time, standing in the middle of the tangled mass of wildflower and greenery. In the autumn, then, I had spent a long time pulling up some of the rewilding vegetation, including a lot of the dried-out forget-me-not plants, thinking that the bottom of the garden would look more cultivated this spring. Well, the plan hasn't worked. Nature has taken its own course, and the area is covered again with a mixture of wild plants and, of course, dandelions and a few weeds. However, I am quite pleased that the forget-me-not flowers have sprouted up again. In even more places this year, I have to say, the dainty blue petals with their delicate yellow centres have persisted against the odds and are providing a determined pale blue carpet on the hard brown earth. Over the last few days, as I've monitored their spread into various parts of the garden, I've taken to musing on their symbolism too. These days of mid-May are a special time of remembering for me. And the forget-me-not flower has offered a sign of that remembrance this year. I know symbolically that there is a perceived association to love and fidelity and long-lasting friendship and connection with those tiny forget-me-not flowers. The sense of not forgetting about someone or something. In a similar sense, as you yourself will always be remembered. There is a certain comfort, I find, in observing their strength of growth, their bright colour, and their resilience. The resilience of those forget-me-not flowers. The resilience of God's remembering. The resilience of God's teachings. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are those who seek mercy. They will inherit the earth. Remembrance. I've been thinking of the places in the Old Testament where God reminds groups of people, particular characters, perhaps, who find themselves in testing circumstances, that they are not or never will be forgotten by him, by God. Noah, Jacob, Moses, Ruth, Esther, Joshua, to name a few, all facing tough situations in their particular stories, decisions, challenging circumstances, yet remembered by God in their various endeavours, and through them God remembering his covenant promises to his people. In the New Testament, when I'm remembering, I will often turn to the passage I read from Matthew's Gospel, from the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus speaks to the people about discipleship, about living life in God's fullness. For me, it offers a stopping place, a time to remember the significant ways of living life in simplicity, thinking about others, seeking to be open and of living life well, trusting in God's mercy, trusting in God's grace. Recently, when I returned to my home city, I was reminded of the early days of learning how to drive a car. At that time, I discovered that there were so many sets of traffic lights along the roads I needed to negotiate, that I had to think very carefully about all that foot and pedal coordination and obeying the changing colours. It reminded me a little about the teachings that we have to kind of follow when we're trying to live a life of discipleship. But in this car, I remember thinking, goodness, I've got to stop in time on the red light. I've got to wait safely through that amber light, and then getting ready to go again once the green light shone. It all seemed quite complicated in the early stages of learning how to drive. I still muse on that combination of commands, especially when I'm immersed in this season, this time of the Christian year, around Easter and Ascension and Pentecost. I like to remember about what those commands, the stopping, the waiting, and the going, might mean for me, especially as I try to live in the light of the passage from Matthew, in the light of those Beatitudes. During the time after Easter, we read about Jesus proving to his disciples that he was alive and reminding them of all his teachings, all that he had said about rising again. And no doubt he would refer again to those teachings he gave them when he was alive with them, like those teachings we find in Matthew's Gospel. This season, I find, offers an opportunity to take time to remember those teachings of faith for ourselves, to stop, to slow down amid our busy lives, and especially at this time with so much going on, so much challenging us in this complex world of ours, threatening to engulf us just now. There is time to ponder on his words and to gaze in wonder and adoration at Christ, who is indeed alive in his divine risen glory. But also perhaps to remember that Jesus is not throned above, remotely high, untouched, unmoved by human pains. He is here with us in the midst of it all, alive, eager to share in all that we endeavour to do in our discipleship, all that we endeavour to do in our daily adventures, helping us to face with courage all that happens to us, the good, the bad, the indifferent, the things in between. We can pause because we can recognise his authority. He is king. He has been given the name above all names, as we are reminded in the Lord's Prayer. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. He has the final word, not the forces of evil or all the human tragedies in this world, which threaten to engulf us in despair. God has not lost control of the world, and he certainly hasn't lost control of our lives as we place them securely in his care. As they saw him again, those disciples would witness to his rising, to be with God. They were assured that he was with them. He was going to pray for them, rising to be with God, at God's right hand, praying. We need to stop perhaps and remember that we're not entirely alone on this life that we lead. God is there praying for us, even at the times when we feel lost, confused, grieving, despairing, wondering what the next thing will bring us, worrying perhaps about being falsely accused. God is there, and we can remember the fact that God has promised in Jesus to be amongst us and with us. Then we have the amber light of waiting. Sometimes that is a very difficult time to be in, and this season of Easter, Ascension and Pentecost speaks to us a bit about waiting too. In the quiet times, God encouraged the disciples to wait for the Holy Spirit that was coming to empower them. Perhaps we are in a waiting time. One of the scriptures says, "They who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not be faint." Isaiah 40 and verse 31 reminds us. Sometimes to wait, if that's where we are, to step back is the only way in the future to step out further for God as we receive his power, his direction, his leading. And then there is the green light. I always was relieved to see the green light when I was there in my car. Getting the green light in any situation can be breathtaking, energizing, a readiness to go. Those disciples, we will hear, will be commissioned by Jesus to go to all places with the good news of God's love, peace, reconciliation, his comfort and his grace, his mercy, as we heard from Matthew, to go on to their homes, the nation, the enemy, to the ends of the earth, to take out the gospel. Jesus still looks for those who will take their faith into every sphere and level of society, to live for him and make him known, to be salt and light, giving glory to him by our acts of kindness, lives of self-giving love and service, as well as in convincing words. Trusting and letting Jesus work in us and through us is so important. To quote William Carey, attempt great things for God and expect great things from God. Forget me not, I go back to that word those little flowers that I thought about in the first instance. Forget me not. As we go about our lives, whatever the challenges, maybe we can remember that God forgets us not. His love for us will always be sure and constant. Whatever persecutions, difficulties, grieving times we face, in the purity and simplicity of living lives that go for God, that wait for him, that stop to wonder at his grace, he will be there helping us, leading us, guiding us along the way. So I pray for you that in your doings, you will remember you have a God who forgets you not, who will give you the strength and the courage to be salt and light in the places he calls you to proclaim his risen, ascending, loving power. God bless you. As those words from Matthew remind us, blessed are you as you pursue his love, life, and kingdom. And I wanted to bring to you one of the hymns. Well, it's a hymn from Singing the Faith, but the words came to me really in the context maybe of some of what this season means about sharing the good news and about remembering that God gives us a way to proclaim. It says this: have you heard the good news? Have you heard the good news? We can live in hope because of what the Lord has done. Have you heard the good news? Have you heard the good news? We can live in hope because of what the Lord has done. So I pray there is a way when there seems to be no way. There is a light in the darkness. There is a hope, an everlasting hope. There is a God who can help us. A hope for justice and a hope for peace. A hope for those in desperation. We have a future if only we believe. He works in every situation. Have you heard the good news? Have you heard the good news? We can live in hope. Have you heard the good news? We can live in hope because of what the Lord has done for us, for you. He will never forget you. His love for you is constant. May that prayer and that hope give us courage to face whatever is coming to us at this time, in this week, in this month. Amen.
Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hand hath made, I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the universe display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When through the woods and forest glades I wander and hear the in humble adoration. graces my soul.